our final video of this term, we talk about another geomorphic, important geomorphic shaper of the landscape, glaciers, and their main glacial processes. So as we'll talk about, as it's seen by, you know, glacier shown in the example behind here, and because of course glaciers are made up of a lot of snow, our song to get us in the mood for this video is Snow, Heyo, by the Red Hot Chili Peppers. So once again, we're talking about geomorphology, and particularly with glaciers, we can refer to their components being all under what we could call the cryosphere, or referring to anything that's basically frozen. Frozen water specifically, so snow, icebergs, ice shelves, glaciers, all these different terms that we have to refer to essentially bodies of ice that are formed on land, or extending out from land into oceans. And so we'll be talking about kind of differences between alpine or mountain glaciers and continental glaciers. But really, regardless, glaciers are kind of almost like what we could term rivers just of ice, because glaciers actually end up flowing downslope or flowing towards what we will call their ablation zone. We'll talk about what that term means here in a little bit. But you know, essentially, they do have some flow to them. They're just a lot slower than rivers, as you know, of course, you could think of, probably in note intuitively. So we've talked about glacial periods in the past, remembering, you know, actually a lot of the past 600,000 years, you know, Earth has actually been in these series of glaciations. You know, only like at present, only a few times we actually had these interglacial periods or warmer periods. And so, you know, our last glacial maximum, last ice age kind of type of time period was about 18,000 years ago at its maximum extent. And we're talking about how really glaciations for both continental glaciers and alpine glaciers were much more extensive then, almost about 30% of Earth's surface compared to presently only being about 10 or 11% or so. And so first we can think, well, you know, we can generally probably have some conceptual understanding of how ice and glaciers form. But really, you know, it's really when you have this kind of repeat snow year after year, you know, snow build up over long periods of time, where that, you know, summer snow loss is less than the winter gain. And as that snow then kind of compacts, you know, compiles on itself and compacts and kind of recrystallizes through more melting and refreezing, essentially becomes more dense and, you know, kind of more packed together. And so we kind of have the stages of snow to what we then call firn, kind of more granular, compacted snow, and then eventually glacial ice, which is really more even further compressed and recrystallized and very dense ice material. And so that's, you know, just building, you know, these glaciers then really, and especially large glaciers can take hundreds to, you know, thousands of years as we, you know, we have this process, I mean, kind of building up with lots and lots of snow over time is needed for building large glaciers. And of course, you know, we can also think intuitively, yes, you know, where of glaciers, you know, the geography of them and the sense of distribution or surface is more like things like high latitudes and or high altitudes at really any latitude. Although that's all going to be dependent on what we could term the snow line. Essentially, the lowest elevation and anything above it in terms of elevation where snow can persist around the year. And it's going to make sense then that the snow line is, you know, and we think of the general rule of it, is that, you know, the snow line is at a lot higher elevation in equatorial region, or, you know, in the low latitudes, so up to 5,000 meters or, you know, tens of thousands of feet, but, you know, much lower in elevation the higher latitude you go. You know, so here's the general rule being, you know, the lower the latitude, the higher the snow line in its elevation, or kind of in reverse, the higher the latitude, the lower the snow line. So, you know, in Greenland, you don't have to go very far at all in terms of going up in elevation. You know, kind of, or Alaska would be another example, compared to, you know, mid-latitudes or equatorial, where you have to go much higher in elevation to reach snow line, and, you know, where we can actually build glaciers up over time. And so it's just showing, also by this kind of drawing out from the past 1800s, this example that was realized then, even, you know, in more equatorial areas, you know, much higher elevations you need for snow line compared to higher latitudes. And mentioned this term earlier about ablation, but again, that's just referring to ablation being where we have loss of ice, or, you know, more melting in a given year than kind of buildup. And so you want, you know, kind of thinking of in both, as we'll come to look at mountain or continental glaciers, you know, areas you want some sort of zone of accumulation where you're adding more snow over that over time compared to losing it. You have then kind of the split between those areas, so where there's an equilibrium line or essentially equal amount of addition and kind of subtraction through ablation, which can be either just melting or other processes like sublimation, just been breaking off of that those glaciers. But you know, generally, you want some amount of zone of accumulation if you're going to continue to have your glacier over time, compared to if you know pretty much all of your glacier is in a zone of ablation. You know, if it's pretty much all melting, of course, you know, it'll eventually melt all away or ablate all away. And because you're not adding really in any meaningful way over time to that glacier. But if, you know, if we have these zones, we'll come to look at, you know, have, again, you're having that flow from and movement of the glacier from its zone of accumulation to its zone of ablation. Because as I just noted earlier, there's actually rivers of ice, so we're flowing here, as shown by this image. Even if they appear stationary, glaciers flow over very small, you know, very incremental, you know, maybe only centimeters, few centimeters a year, perhaps, you know, in terms of their movement, so we can't really perceive that in human timescales, you know, but they are eroding material and moving it downslope and depositing it. So we'll kind of, again, then talk about these different aspects of different types of glaciers. So continental glaciers, really, you know, today we only have them at the poles, so Antarctica and Greenland are the two main examples. So, you know, with Antarctica, we have the Antarctic ice sheet, which covers the continent, but it also extends out to, you know, into parts of the ocean, and there's, you know, kind of extensive, what we call ice shelves that extend out over into parts of the ocean there as well. And even, you know, though we have kind of underlying parts of continent, we could term it, at least land mass underneath our where Antarctica presently sits, if we actually term it as a continent. And so, you know, the just a term that's often used in reference to these mountain peaks that still stick above the ice sheet, we call them nunataks. So these mountain peaks here that are still protruding out of the glacial ice that's built up here. And so that's actually what this map on the right of Antarctica here is showing, is kind of in these redder areas, kind of deeper ice accumulation and depth down to the actual rock or, you know, material, you know, the land of Antarctica, versus, you know, these bluer colors where the ocean is, or kind of greener, lighter areas being where there's not as much depth to either land or water. And similarly, you know, here showing ice Greenland, excuse me, where, you know, densest kind of in the middle, or, you know, deepest where you could drill down, and then kind of extending out to its margins where, you know, it's much less deep to you would hit land. And so, you know, kind of similarly, you know, the Greenland ice sheet though is only about an eighth of the size of Antarctica, although, you know, even if it were to melt or have almost total melting, would still cause quite a bit of sea level rise around the oceans of the world, so up to 10 to 15 feet, or, you know, a few meters, which is pretty extensive, actually would inundate quite a lot of coastal areas even then. So it does hold a lot of water in that sense, stored up in these ice sheets. Now, again, that's the present extent, but actually we've talked a little bit about past climate changing and, you know, all these ice ages, and so also thinking back to ice sheets and more extensive parts of them, we talked about almost 30% of Earth's land mass covered by these ice sheets in the last glacial maximum. And so showing that here, so way more extensive across much of North America here, extensive parts, also, you know, parts of Northern Europe, much more extensive in the Himalaya as well, generally just much more areas that were covered either both by elevation and or latitude affected here. But, you know, we're going to show this this diagram here that just shows you know, as those glaciers then receded, you know, as they melted in you know, more recent times, in terms of recent thousands of years, and kind of moved back into their present extents with Antarctica and or Greenland, we end up having, you know, those landscapes left behind, a series of landscapes that are shaped. Because really, we can actually think of glaciers, you know, one of the analogies that I often use to think of them, that I kind of think of them like huge bulldozers. I mean, they're, you know, these huge blocks of ice that can be, you know, hundreds of meters, you know, so really, you know, hundreds of feet high at times even higher than that. They essentially come through these landscapes and plow through, kind of remove a lot of whatever was there prior. But as they recede, as we're seeing in this diagram here, they actually also then leave behind a whole set of their own geomorphic features and essentially kind of marks on the landscape that we know that they existed there in the past. So there's things like moraines, these till and outwash plains, and as well as a series of other little things. Drumlins, eskers, cairns, kettle lakes, we'll talk through a little bit here as well. So, you know, these moraines are where essentially they have linear ridges of glacial material that's left behind. So again, we're essentially, one example of these moraines are what we call terminal moraines. So that was the outermost limit that was reached by the ice sheet. And that provides the greatest evidence of where our greatest glacial extent was. So again, because you had that glacier that's flowing out, it's bringing material as it's kind of bulldozing, scraping everything through. That's all getting actually deposited out at the terminal moraine that extended. So it actually built up kind of a ridge there out where its greatest extent was. But you can also have recessional moraines. So where, if you have your glacier recede over some period, but then it kind of stalls out. So you get like a cold period for about 100 years kind of stuck in there, in that greater period of thousands of years of general warming that's making the glacier retreat. You can still have kind of a smaller moraine that's built up where that glacier kind of stalls for some while, again, because it's bringing through all that material as it's slowly flowing through, picking up all the material kind of underneath it. And we can still deposit quite a bit and build up some sort of depositional material in a smaller recessional moraine. But then also, as we can see through this diagram, and we're having to see all this flow of that melt water coming out. And so this can also then lead to a lot of that material getting washed out, either till and or outwash. And so the till is more poorly sorted sediments. And so that's, we see this example on the left hand here. So we see kind of very fine materials, sands that are mixed in with really big boulders. So that's not really well sorted. Unlike though our outwash, which is more from the melt water, it's carrying sediment some distance from glacier, and so it's kind of deposited more on these layers here, and all relatively of the same size, all kind of the sandy layers that we're seeing on this right-hand example. So that's almost more like rivers that we saw with those examples. The river we talked about, its alluvium being deposited there, and so just noting, that's an example tied to that. But also then some of these other features, these eskers, these deposits of former channels that essentially were beneath an ice sheet. So he was showing on the right hand side here, we actually had the ice overlying. Actually, it's not just a one solid block of ice, but oftentimes, as that ice is retreating and a lot of that water's melting, it kind of pools through actually parts of the center of the glacier and runs, almost has river channels that flow through the middle of it, because again, that's carrying some of that sediment, all the stuff that's kind of stuck up within the glacier, and ends up then almost leaving behind an inverted river channel, a river bed, of material that's been deposited by all that flowing water underneath the glacier. As you see that in these eskers here, so you see this long, sinuous kind of deposit, set of material that's left behind, or these, kind of slightly sinuous ridges that are made of really mostly sands and gravels that are left behind. And another, key, understanding to knowing that glaciers were here in the past. Another example is these drumlins, so these kind of asymmetrical teardrop shaped hills. So we're looking at them from either from the side or from the top down here, and showing that we have a steeper slope on the front face, and then this more mild slope that shows us the direction of our ice sheet's movement. And these often occur in a series of all of them occurring together in what we term these drumlin fields here. So you can see this example, like this is from western New York State here. There's whole sets of drumlins, and they're all pointing out towards Lake Ontario here, where the ice sheet moved relatively north or kind of northwest. But also, just another example here, we have this drumlin here. Another example again of that sharp front face, what we call the Stoss side, and then the long drawn out lee side here. And then transitioning now a little bit between, kind of to wrap up our continental glaciers and then actually move to alpine glaciers and kind of bridge the gap between this. This example of actually also big glacial floods that can come out of these ice sheets as well. And so actually when you get kind of these ice sheets kind of damming up a bunch of water behind them, and then having, you know, when that ice as melts kind of break loose and let huge amounts of water flow through at once, it's actually what's caused a whole shaping of, if you actually go out and look at a lot of the landscapes across both Oregon and Washington and exit areas, you know, actually lots of parts of eastern Washington, some of these areas that's a lot of exposed bedrock, kind of areas that's all been shaped by these huge outwash floods. It's known as the Channeled Scablands in eastern Washington, and all that water flowed through down what is now presently the Columbia River, and actually a lot of it backed up into the present-day Willamette River Valley. And actually one of the reasons why growing a lot of crops here is such good business, actually, because of really all that material that was deposited there within the Willamette Valley because of these big floods that occurred several thousand years ago in the past. So that kind of ends our more continental glacier part and moves us more to alpine glaciers, looking at present day alpine glaciers that we saw with this, you know, slide here. And, you know, to note that one of the differences between how we can know when a valley in the mountains has been impacted by glaciers or when it's been impacted by rivers is that the rivers, as we kind of have more of this V shape to them, where valleys that have been shaped by big alpine glaciers in the past, even if they're not there anymore, have a larger U shape. And so that's what this graphic is showing you here. So we have this formation right here of the big alpine glacier, and as it retreats, we end up then having this big U-shaped valley that's left behind of it. So this produces other then series of geomorphic features behind it. So glacial troughs and these, you know, kind of hanging valleys also that can come off of tributary glaciers to the main big glacier as well. As we can see, the, you know, big U-shaped valleys here, examples left behind compared to the more V-shaped valleys of streams, that or streams are the main geomorphic agent from really recent times. And so then we end up seeing with these formation of these a whole other series of late landforms, so cirques, arêtes, horns. A lot of these are French name, kind of have different French basis to them, like cirque, bowl, arête, or kind of knife. All these different features that we end up getting forming because of these glacial components. So here, when we actually are glaciated, we see these with the main glacier. And just another example here, so we see these arêtes, horn, different parts of the valley glacier. But then when we actually then remove those glaciers off of the landscape, again, we have our U-shaped valley here, arêtes, these lakes that are often left behind, kind of depressions, these cirques. You can see all of these different components here that are kind of left behind on landscape, with this example here being part of Yosemite National Park with the example on the right. But really many landscapes that have been past glaciated all show this same type of sets of landscapes, geomorphic features left behind on landscape. Another great example is Glacier National Park within the United States, kind of a prime example of that. Alpine glacier erosion here. Not going to really go into this in any great detail, but if you're interested in the processes and the features that are kind of left behind from that, you can look more into that here. But also just these, again, talking about these different types of moraines. So moraines that are also kind of on the sides of the glacier, are those lateral moraines, and the medial moraines are the ones that are actually in the middle where multiple glaciers, these different types of valley or mountain glaciers come together. And this also, we end up also having with mountain glaciers, another kind of, when mountain glaciers meet the ocean, and so in these coastal areas, you end up also getting what are known as fjords. So we end up seeing these mostly in kind of Norway, but also other areas around in northern Europe. So these areas where we had alpine glaciers and last glacial maximum that reached the sea. And so when they retreated, essentially the ocean kind of filled back in behind where those ice, you know, ice carved out all that area, and so that allowed the intrusion of the oceans much inland in much of these areas. So there's kind of an aerial example here, a false color image showing the, you know, white of the snow, the red is showing more vegetated areas, and then our, you know, we can see our blue of our water here, the,
of these fjords coming in, where these past glaciers and mountain glaciers extended out into the ocean out here. And so we kind of come to the end, where I'll conclude is, you know, kind of present day, bring us back to present day, and kind of mountain glacier changes in the past few decades. And looking around, we've talked about issues of climate change, and so we can guess that, yes, many, and see an observation here that many of our glaciers are retreating, are kind of effectively thinning, as we have shown in this here, and so most of them, you know, there are exceptions to the rule, but most of them, as we look around, have show some sign of effective thinning in terms of their meters per year, and that either being, you know, how much they're losing in terms of their kind of height or elevation, how much buildup they have of ice, or just kind of also retreat, oftentimes up in elevation or in latitude, as we're seeing. So that just kind of brings us then back to that present day and kind of ties us back to some of our broader concepts we talked about with issues such as climate change and other climatic factors that we talked about in the first part of the class. But that's all I have for you. You know, as I say, that's all, folks. And so look at the study guide for the final exam. Use that to guide your studying. And also, please, you've made it here all the way to this end of this video. Before I cut out, give a plug for filling out the teaching evaluations on DuckWeb. Thank you in advance. You know, I really take those seriously. I want to hear from you. What was the good? What was the bad? You know, let me know. You know, how was your online class experience? I want to know, hear all about, again, the things that hopefully went well, but also, you know, if you have suggestions, I'm definitely open and want to make this course as good as it can be in the future. So thank you for your input again on that. And of course, thank you for taking the course and listening through these lecture videos.